And it ranges from short webinars like today to full certificates and customized trainings. Let's see. Now, you'll notice that you are all muted, and we're going to have some opportunity for conversation later. But just for a start, we're going to let Ava get going here, since we're running a couple minutes late. But you will notice that we do have the live transcription on. If you would like to turn that off, there is an option to close to end that closed caption by clicking the hide subtitle on your Zoom toolbar. And with that, I will turn it over to Ava McGee, who is one of our instructors for the Certified Public Manager program. And go ahead, take it away, Ava.
All right. Hello, beautiful people. Happy lunchtime. I'm glad you're here to join with us today, talking about infusion of inclusion. And this is our summer sampler part of it. So this is going to be more or less a lunchtime dialogue. So I hope that you're ready. And so we are on our way. All right, so let's start. So I want to welcome everyone. Thank you for just showing up in this space. I know this is a choice. So I thank you for choosing to, you know, spend time in this space with me in dialogue, right? And so I'm not here to, this is not a training. I wish they changed that dialogue a little bit and just maybe say having some sparkly moments, right? Because it's all about educating ourselves and learning and growing. So these are our agreements for today. And I want you to do a thumbs up if you are in agreement with these. I'm gonna go through them real fast. Our agreements and norms for the day is to stay engaged. That means I will remain committed to the journey, knowing that my commitment to equity and doing my personal work in discovery, understanding, and growth is forever evolving. So this is not a one and done. It's like every day you learn something new, all right? So expect to experience discomfort, and there's nothing wrong with discomfort. Some shares may be a little bit like quirky or kind of quirky. Just know that it's a part of the process. It's a part of learning, and it's a part of growing. So in that, I am prioritizing equity over my discomfort and will be intentional about leaning in to the conversation and the moment. Because sometimes you may have understand that. All right, let's go to the next piece. Speak your truth. That means using I statements. I'm speaking my truth through my lived experience, and I am choosing to be honest about my biases and how they impact my practice. So your practice behavior. And also expect and accept a lack of closure. Understand that this is a process and that the growth in this area continues the journey of my evolution. So always know that the more you learn, it's data, right? So the more you experience is data. So just understand that. And I'm not gonna do introductions because there's like 74 people in this room right now. I am going to go into this video, and right now I'm asking that you are present to what you see on the screen, and then afterwards we'll have a full out conversation and kind of get more into our subject. All right, so before we go, is everybody in agreement with the norms? And of course the agreements, you can do a thumbs up. Go down the thingy. Yay, yay. All right, that looks like majority of the people here. So I appreciate that. So let's go into this video. This video I found some time ago, and I love it because it's a simple way of understanding what inclusion is, and also have an understanding of what access is also, right? All right, so let's go into it. And like I said, afterwards, we're gonna have a conversation. So here we go. Thank you. Close it out. Now, so I wanted to show that video because it gives us an idea of what inclusion is. And some, I mean, like every day we go out through our life and we live, we breathe and all, do all the good things, right? So the next slide has like a bunch of words on it. Just words: diversity, inclusion, equity, othering, belonging, love, acceptance, understanding, kindness, access, culture, patience. And yes, I said love. Love, 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 love. We're all human. We're all human. We all have our own experiences, whether it's a lived experience or just life in general. And to get to the point where we understand that in order for us to embark on what it is considered inclusion, there has to be that human aspect, right? It has to be that love that garners our attention. It garners our relevance. It garners our everything, like literally our everything. It's how we react or interact with each other. And it's a way of being fully expressive, right? Without just grabbing your coworker and just hugging them. And some people do. I mean, it's nothing wrong with that. I think everybody should hug their coworkers. With respect. So just in general, we throw out these words and they mean absolutely nothing if the behavior behind the words aren't like working to evolve situations, honor people who are in places and times and things, and wherever you go, wherever you are, whether it's in your business or whether you are out in the world. Because for me, my personal bridges with my professional, right? So how I'm behaving now with you is how I behave out in the world with other people that I come in contact with. And so in those words, I want to have like, I want to hear stories. I want to hear stories about, and I'll start. I want to hear stories about things that have occurred in your life that I want to hear the stories about having experienced the nuances of like anti-diversity or anti-inclusion or anti-equity, anti-othering. I want to hear those stories. And then also after we hear those stories, I want to hear stories about when you did experience a moment with inclusion, even if it were you, the person that offered some hand to someone else, as far as like having a conversation or, oh, what happened? Hold on. My oopsie, hold on 1 second. I must have pushed a button. There you go. So is everybody able to see that now? I hope so.
Yes.
Talking away. Great. Thank you. Thank you. So with that understanding of knowing that in our workplace, we experience different occurrences that happen that may not seem, I would say it in a sense, on the up and up. So this is my story. It's actually someone else's experience that was share it with me. So in the life of diversity, equity, and inclusion, and I also include access because you can't have any of those things without having access. I had a friend explain to me, you know, she received this position and it was a diversity, like a director position. In that position, she was excited because she read the mission, she read the goals and the values of that organization. And she was excited because now she gets to make a difference more so than she did before. Right. And so having the understanding that she knew what her purpose was. She knew what her purpose was. These things, hold on 1 second. She she knew what her purpose was, and she knew that she was excited about taking on the challenge, right? No, understanding that there were a lot of dilemmas within that organization that they wanted to remedy. And so when she started reviewing policies and procedures and wanting to put like a equity lens in the processes and the procedures of the organization, she started getting a lot of pushback, And she felt that it was a, she asked questions. She was like, okay, I don't know why this is happening. They invited me to the table, but they're not allowing me to eat. And so when you're invited to the table, not being allowed to eat, that means you're not getting nourishment. And the table is not providing nourishment, because it's like, it's just there. The table is there and you are just sitting there, and then you see all the food, you see everything around you. However, you're not able to be involved. So you're not able to make changes in policies or procedures or the strategic plan or anything that has to do with the fulfillment of their DEI face, right? So it's forward facing on the website, it's forward facing in the mission, values, and goals, yet it's not forward facing in action. And so she found herself in a dilemma. And in that dilemma, she had to make a decision. You know, after 6 months of just sitting at the table, you've seen all the food, you've seen people get served, but you're not able to partake, and you're not able to, provide advice or any type of inquiry at that point, because it got to a point where she was just literally there. And so she, in our conversations, was like, what should I do? I'm like, that's not the space for you. If you went in intentionally thinking that, okay, this is what I'm here for, this is my it's like a dream come true, my job come true. And then she wasn't able to act in that position. She wasn't able to perform in that position. And then she found out that that position was a performative space. It wasn't an actionable space. And so all the diversity, equity, and inclusion stuff went out the window, because she wasn't able to do the job that she was hired for. And so looking at that, and then also understanding there are organizations that do that. They hire and they basically say, hey, this is what you're supposed to do, but don't touch it. You sit in the room, but touch anything. Just don't touch anything. So which is frustrating, because if you're saying that that's what you're about, and then when you are brought issues to, assist in resolving, and then you're like, oh, it's a bit too much right now. Like, what are you doing? Like, what are you doing? So that's my example. And I had to, in the work that I'm doing, I had to understand that some people they're not ready truly, right? Because within that also is shared power. And a lot of times people, organizations say they want shared power. However, they don't know how to enact on that shared power. They don't know how to share. And so that was a really kind of a bad experience for her and for us, because we had hope for the organization and, all the excitement, and it kind of like went away. So I don't know what they're doing now. Yeah, I know she's doing well now. She's able to thrive in her position. And maybe that was the thing, that particular position wasn't for her. But however, nevertheless, she is in a space now where she is able to thrive and grow and love and do all those beautiful things. So it turned out to be good with somebody else. Sometimes that happens. So by a show of hands, anybody want to share a story of the negative side of what that actually looks like, and what you learned from that. And if we could do it within like a 30-second timeline, that would be wonderful. And you can raise your hand and I'll pay attention to hands. be shy. This is a safe place. This is Vegas. We can share the stories and not the people.
Looks like Gustavo has a raised hand.
I can't see. Can I go ahead? Do you see them?
Yes, they're. Go ahead, Gustavo.
Thank you.
Hey, everyone. Well, really quick. I don't think you can see me, but let me see. I'm gonna try. So anyway, what I'm trying to say is, I've been working for different agencies for over 20 years, and I can tell you that if you get a job and, you know, they said they're inclusive, whatever, and if they're not, or if you feel like it, you don't belong there, just move. Mm-hmm. Just go to a different place. That's what I'm gonna say, because you know it right away. You know it right away, and you don't have to be in a place where they don't appreciate you. It's like adopting a child, but you don't have the environment for the child. So if they don't have the environment for you, don't be there. Thank you.
True. Thank you. Thank you. Does anybody else want to share a story? Or a point of view?
Destiny has a hand up, Ava.
Go ahead.
Hi, Destiny. I'm trying to see. I have to lower my thing and I'm trying to see it and I can't see anything. Go ahead, Destiny. And thank you for whoever is looking out for me on that, in that area, because I cannot see a single thing. Go ahead, Destiny.
Stephanie, I think, is the one with a raised hand.
Oh, okay.
Oh, Stephanie. Okay, go ahead, Stephanie.
This is Stephanie. So I guess I just have a real short thing that has happened to me at more than one company, and that is like being promoted into a position where you start to attend more like managerial or executive level meetings, and then being asked questions, but being talked over and not allowed to answer them.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, I will attach a copy of the PowerPoint, Angie.
Brett, would you like to go next? I see your hand raised there.
Yeah, I'm a older 50s white guy, but I've worked for a number of different organizations, and there was many times when I saw that they were trying to, they would send in an outside organization looking for information on how people felt in the workplace, and, you know, in particular, folks from the BIPOC community. And what I typically found from my friends who were in that community working there was that they were uncomfortable talking about some of the issues that they were dealing with, and myself, who would have felt perfectly comfortable talking about the issues because I could see a lot of the issues that were going on. Nobody wanted to hear my voice. And I always found that a little bit off-putting, because I feel like anybody who pays attention and has an open mind can at least be able to see and participate and try to, you know, make sure that everybody else is actually being heard. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Jennifer, got you up there next.
Jennifer?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay. I'll just share a really quick example. Being part of a team in an IT heavy project where I was representing folks who were affected by some of the IT issues, and my male supervisor in a kind of a strategizing team meeting where there was a crisis, saying well, this is what we think, this is what Jennifer thinks, this is what, you know, and I definitely did not think that or feel those things. And so I had to say to the group, I can speak for myself, thank you. And and here's what I actually think. And that really began a pretty downhill slide between myself and that supervisor. So.
Oh, wow. Okay. So what do you think that could have been, other than you speaking up for yourself, what engagement would you have invited into that conversation? Like, what would you have invited in that conversation at that moment?
I think having room allowed for a little bit more of the rubber meets the road impact on a pretty wide population of affected folks should have been a little more welcomed and considered in those considerations. I think in oftentimes in IT, there's a matter of how big of a scope is this? How many people does it affect? And if it's a really big amount, then it gets a lot more attention. So I think just having that, if it's a problem, it's a problem and it's important and it needs to be heard perspective would have been more helpful.
Awesome. Thank you. And how can you offer that in the future?
Oh, well, I don't work for that supervisor anymore. And so okay. I just continue to say what's on my mind and advocate for the points of view of the folks who need to be heard.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you
so much. Because that's what it's about, right? And that's why, and for me, that's a main reason why I am here. Because a lot of, and the reason why I said these are words on the screen or like these are words on the paper, because they are. Until you are able to like act on them, it's words on the screen, basically. So when you take action, that I think that is a very, very great way to start. So thank you so much for that. Really appreciate it. Okay.
I'm going to... Oh, and we have one more person who still has their hand raised.
Awesome. Thank you. Go ahead.
My name is Michelle, and I just wanted to share a quick something that was surprising to me. Early in my career, I moved from Washington State to South Carolina. I'm going to date myself here, but at the time I had key punch training at 10,000 strokes an hour. So I was looking for a job as soon as I got there. I talked to them on the phone. I explained what my experience and rating was. And they said, we have several openings. But when I showed up, they told me I sounded white on the phone. Now, what startles me is 20 years later, here in Washington State, I was in a position where it was not welcoming. And like the gentleman said earlier, I just wanted to be somewhere else. Okay. And so I applied for a position at a temporary agency, even now having more skills, more qualified. Did the same thing, called them. We have several positions. I came in and as soon as I got there, they told me there was no openings. And as I was leaving, I overheard one of the ladies say, didn't she sound white on the phone? So it's not being not inclusive and not diversified is not limited by any location.
Right. Yeah, I grew up in Mississippi. So that's all I got to say about that. that was an experience, you know, by itself. And that was one of the reasons why I was so attracted, you know, coming to Washington. But then overt versus covert is life.
It's here too. And my husband's from Mississippi. He said it's a great place to be from.
Exactly. I say that all the time. Yep. I still got relatives there though. So I get to see them every once in a while. Yeah. So thank you for that. I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Yeah. They say things are changing rapidly. And then sometimes it seems like it hasn't changed at all. So, and I would say it depends on what day it is, right? So there you go. So thank you for that. Appreciate it. One more share before we get to the second piece. I'll read from the chat box. I saw Sarah Lynn's. Let me make sure I'm not missing anybody else. Okay. Da-da-da. Okay, Erica, are you going to post that to some type of way? Erica says she wrote an article about her bad experiences and lessons learned. I would love to see that. So this is being recorded. So hopefully we'll be able to grab that after we leave this space. All right, so Sarah Lynn says, at my last employer, every person I met initially asked me, did you move here with your partner or boyfriend? When I told them I had moved from out of state, it seemed like such a little thing, but as a youngish single queer woman, it made me feel like other. So can you tell us a little bit more about that, Sarah Lynn? Please.
Okay, sure. There's not a lot else to tell, but as an aromantic, single, queer person coming to a new place, and the first question everyone asks me is, basically my relationship status, mm-hmm. right? It was off-putting. I feel like there are a lot of more interesting things about me. And it's, I think it's a good example of, small things where the interest is, oh, I want to learn more about you, mm-hmm. about who you are and your context. But the question is asked in such a way that it is presuming something, right? Okay. It's presuming that as a young person, as a young woman, well, then you had to have moved here with someone else.
Gotcha.
Yeah,
gotcha.
And you must be partnered up. And it was kind of like, I don't know you. I don't particularly want to get in. It's complicated. Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you. I appreciate that. Appreciate clarity all the time. Brett Wolf says, I may not have worded that well when I spoke. It just meant that I saw a lot of issues in the workplace that concerned me personally. There were issues like equity in the workplace. I never wanted to speak or make myself heard in place of their own voice. I just wanted a chance to add mine to hopefully help strengthen it. Thank you, Brett. I appreciate that. So Rosalind, you want to share really quickly?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
So there was this job where my resume went before me, uh-huh. and they were so enthusiastic about meeting me, you know, and they spoke to me on the phone. And when I got there, I shocked the office because of me being, you know, African American, right? Uh-huh. And so I did my job and I did it well. I was working for a temp agency. And, you know, when you work for a temp agency, you want to be able to be hired full time, you know. And so I had all the accolades and all, you know, everybody was applauding and praising, you know, of my, my job ethics, you know, and what I've done, you know. And so, but the supervisor, when it came time for my assignment to be in, you know, to end, she said to me that she had a job for me. And I said, oh, I was just so happy about being able to be hired full time, you know. Mm-hmm. And then she told me, yeah, there's an opening in the factory. And I was like, excuse me, doing what? You know, she wanted me to be on the line. For what? You know, that's not what I came here for, you know, because, you know, the job I took was like in the office. It's like, no, you know, because I went to school. No. And she was like shocked that I would not take that, you know, factory job. And I'm not knocking people who have to take it, you know, but I'm saying when you go to school, you expect to do things, you know, do something different, you know. Mm-hmm. And I was, you know, I was expecting her to give me, a permanent position in the office. But no, she was trying to send me to the line. And so I was like, okay, no, thank you, you know. And she was just, she was shocked. She actually was shocked that I refused the job. She was shocked.
Thank you for that. Thank God for knowing who you are. That's one thing. I don't know. I always say my father was always my coach. So he was always my cheerleader. He was always the one just, you know, pushing me forward. And I'm sure that is for a lot of people. I just especially appreciate mine because there are a lot of instances where I wanted to say, forget these people and this stuff, right? And so for me, it's like I have to be like, hearing my dad's voice in the back of my head, you know, saying, push forward, baby, push. It's fine. It's okay. You'll get through this. So I appreciate that. Thank you so much. So now we're going to go to the other side real fast. So the other side is this. Tell me of an experience where, and I think Brett kind of mentioned that earlier, like where he was able to kind of put a voice to reasoning, right? So tell me an experience where you actually had to speak up for someone, where you may have felt uncomfortable. So something you either witnessed that someone else spoke up for someone, or you were able to speak up for someone in an instance, whether it's work or outside, just living and breathing in the world. So I want to hear those stories too. So 30 seconds, I'm not going to time you. I'm going to trust that you can speak and bravely within 30 seconds of your share. So go ahead. So I can't see hands. So I think I need to do this in order for me to see the hands. I think, I don't know. So can somebody watch out for me for hands, please?
Yep. I'll let you know if hands pop up.
Awesome. So I'll go first for this one too. So I was in, I think it was like a Federal Express shop in Olympia. So living in Olympia. So we're in Olympia, Federal Express shop. I think we're just checking on getting copies of something. There was a Caucasian lady in front of me, and the lady behind the counter was maybe Asian or Pacific Islander descent. And they were talking, and the Caucasian lady didn't understand what she was saying. So she looks at me and my daughter and says, ugh, I can't understand. I don't even understand her. I don't even know what she's saying. And I thought to myself, she's right there. Talk to her. And so I said out of my mouth, oh, she's right there. Talk to her. You can ask for clarity. And she looked at us as if we were supposed to co-sign about her disgust about the lady behind the counter. And I wasn't going to go there, you know? And so for me, it was like, oh, that was weird. And I looked at my daughter, and my daughter's like, yeah, mom, why was she thinking that we were? So it was kind of weird. And so after that, after the lady got done and moved to the side, and I said, thank you so much for just providing just so much good, you know, good service. And I thank you for just not like feeding into the lady's, you know, behavior. And I said, I applaud you. So thank you so much. And then I turned and looked at the lady and smiled, and that was it. And my daughter was like, anyway, so that's my story. I'm sticking with it. So anybody else want to share? So quiet. Anybody else have a story? And I can't see hands. I can't see anything. Oh my, I see no hands.
We have Suzanne has raised her hand.
Thank you, Suzanne. Suzanne? And you can always put something in the chat too. I'm willing to read it out.
Sorry, I just couldn't find the right button for the unmute. I worked at a private school in California that talked a lot about working on recruiting and having a more diverse student body. Mm-hmm. And they would get these students in the sixth grade entry year, and then in every year at the end of the year, there would be one Black male that just, you know, they would let go because they couldn't cut it. And after I saw this happen a couple of years, I started making waves about the pattern and said, hey, if you're going to recruit students that, you know, you say they're good enough to, they're able to function here, then you have an obligation to help them be able to be successful in this environment. It's not check, you're accepted, and that's all there is to it. It's about supporting them. And I worked with a group for several years to figure out how we could help students who came from really very different socioeconomic backgrounds, and not just the academic part, but the social part was really challenging. And we had a similar kind of challenge around employees that were hired as well. So it was, you know, not an easy problem to solve. And I'm not sure it really is solved yet, but at least there was progress where we were not losing those students every year. And, you know, they could progress through the school and be successful and graduate. So that was a good thing.
Awesome. Thank you. So speaking up is important. So thank you. I appreciate that. Hillary Dykstra, you had your hand raised.
Hi, can you hear me okay?
You can, yes.
Sorry, my voice is a little hoarse. Well, this is like a really long time ago, but when I was in high school, I worked at a fast food restaurant, and I was in the break room with three other young people that I worked with, two guys and a female, and the two guys, one of them was actually like a shift supervisor, so he was kind of in an authority position, but also very young, and we were all, you know, young and immature, and the two guys started to joke about the girl, the other girl that was in the break room with us all, and at first it was harmless, but then it became like more and more inappropriate, and I could tell that she was getting very uncomfortable, and they like, I do not like confrontation, but I also don't like to see people being bullied, and I think my 16, 17 year old self is just like, oh my gosh, this has to stop. This has to stop. How do I stop it? And so I just started yelling, shut up, shut up, shut up, just shut up. And the two guys just immediately, I think they stopped and were silent. They didn't get mad. They didn't like retaliate. I think it's almost like they suddenly realized what they were doing. But that was, I don't know, it was such a like weird moment, but also like kind of a powerful moment in like realizing that I could stand up for somebody else, and that it could impact like the way the other people are behaving. I mean, I probably wouldn't stand up and yell that on that in my, you know, 30 something year old self, but yeah, that's just, I guess, my little experience that I think about from time to time, and I hope that I will be brave to do that again when I come across similar, you know, to be someone's ally.
Awesome. Thank you. I appreciate that. Real time is amazing. Amazing, amazing. So Ginny Wilson-Beard. Ginny Wilson-Beard.
Hello, thank you.
Hello. Welcome.
So just to share real quickly, I used to work at a banking call center many years ago. And one time I had a customer call in and I was verifying his information and he was giving me his address and he goes, Lake Oswego, or as we call it, Lake No Negro. And I just went totally silent. And he goes, wait, you're not Black, are you? And I was like, no, but my husband and children are. I will be unable to help you with this transaction and disconnected the call. But even something as simple as that, you don't know who you're talking to at any time. And for someone to say something like that, I was never more offended in my life.
Thank you for sharing. I appreciate that. That was brave of you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So sometimes it's like we have these experiences, good, bad, or indifferent, right? And they're also educational moments. I'm going to read Erica's real fast. Erica Chin says, I have this really strong memory from when I was a kid on the way to school. I used to run into the bagel shop while my mom waited in the car. I was waiting in line, and when it was my turn, an adult cut in front of me. I spoke up for myself and said, actually, I was in line and I'm next. Been speaking up for myself ever since. Yay! That's awesome. I don't know. Some we do have our moments that we have a I guess like a responsibility and an accountability to ourselves to be true, to ourselves to be love, ourselves to have opportunities like that, right? To speak up for yourself and be able to kind of move into those moments, even when it feels like, oh, maybe I shouldn't be saying this because, you know, and so I appreciate all the stories and all the shares. So this is the next thing is think about everything that you've heard, right? So what specifically did you see or experience today that stands out for you and what seems important? So sometimes when we hear other people's stories, we kind of visualize, like as they're talking, you're walking them through the story. So you're visualizing these things that other people are sharing, right? And so what's dawning for you now? And what connections or understanding are you willing to make in progressing in your evolution? Because I always see it as an evolution, because you may do a certain thing and it may just flop, right? You may be in a certain situation in real time, you're not able to respond. You're not able to say, hey, that statement you just made, can we have dialogue? Can we have a discussion? Or about that thing I just saw you do, is it possible for you to kind of like reconsider, reframe? I can speak for myself. Sometimes I find myself in situations where I am wanting to make sure that when I show up, right, I'm not just here for me. I'm not in service of myself or to myself. I'm in service of the people that I am surrounded by. So when there is a situation or circumstance that comes up, I will speak on it. And I speak out about it all the time. So much so until my daughter will be, you know, like if we're together, she'll look at me and then she'll, you know, she knows I'll say something, because I feel like people, the othering thing is not necessary. People want to belong. I mean, we're all part of the human race. So we all want to have an opportunity to, you know, to share in love, sharing the love. You would love someone before you even like them, because the love is like automatic. Even when you think you don't like them or can't stand them, and when they come in your presence, it's a totally different story, because you're automatically love, right? And so with that understanding, what have you taken from the stories you've heard, and what are you willing to do next to do something different in your life? And if it's thinking about real time, that works. We have about 7 minutes. So if you can share within the next 7 minutes, or actually let's do 6 minutes and then I'll kind of close out everything. So I see Jennifer Smith has her hand raised. You want to share, Jennifer?
Hi, sure. Yeah, I can be quick. So something that stood out was what Sarah Lynn said around people's attempts to kind of, you know, do that little bit of chatting back and forth to try and get to know somebody based on what is applicable in your own life and experience and relationship wise, rather than trying to meet people at more of a neutral or just asking what are your interests, you know, rather than trying to assume any knowledge. I think that's a really important one, and I appreciate that that being part of this. I'm the parent of a non-binary adult queer child who's trying to navigate life in a very unfriendly state to their presentation. And so while I often keep things around diversity very front of mind, the application of diversity to and equity and inclusion ideas to more than just kind of racial equality or gender-based interactions, to remember that it applies in lots of different ways, that we're different in lots of different ways, and to just try and approach with more of that sense of curiosity, where you're not automatically sort of putting somebody into a place where they feel defensive and you didn't even mean to just really shift your question asking in just the tiniest little turn can open it up, I think, to be more opening and welcoming to others that you don't know yet. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you too. I appreciate that. Shifting, I call it reframing. So that's beautiful. That's beautiful. Thank you. And I saw some hands. I see a hand. Hold on 1 second. Go back up a little bit. Benita Horn.
Yes, thank you. I think my takeaway from all of this is just the importance of speaking up. You know, I grew up with a mom who felt as as her daughter, as a Black child, that my role in life was to not make waves and was to fit in. And somehow that never worked for me. And and so, you know, I learned the importance early of speaking up for myself, because generally, if I didn't, no one else did. And, you know, when my kids were young, you know, if we were like, say, someplace in line and somebody else like of another gender or race cut in front of us, you know, they would look at me and they say, "Mom, don't say anything. Don't say," but they knew I was going to, and I did. And I have a good loud voice. I would say it very loudly. Right. But, you know, but one of the things that resonated with me out of all of our sharing, you know, was that poem by Martin Niemöller, you know, the one that says, you know, first they came for the socialists and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists. I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak for me. Wow. And I love that poem, and I think it just really underscores what a lot of us have been saying, that we must speak up.
Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate that so much. So I'm going to read Stephanie, and I think I had somebody else's hand. Let me look. So thank you, Benita. I think we are good. All right, so I have this in the chat box. I'm reading from Stephanie. I don't want to mess your up. Stephanie in the chat box. I'm not messing your name up. One thing I've learned is that oftentimes in groups or meetings, uncomfortable silences are needed to get some people to share their opinions. So I will give more space. I will give more. Go back up. So I'll give more. Hold on. I get some quirky. Uh, Thank you for your patience. I did something. I messed the thingy up. Oh gosh, that's horrible. Could somebody read that for me from Stephanie?
I can fill in for you here.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I will give more space to allow others to speak and for me to hear their voice.
Awesome. I when I'm doing like sessions like this, I use the concept of wait. Why am I talking? That's if I've been talking the whole time, or the, you know, participants, not me, because, you know, the participants, like having them understand to give voice to someone else. And then there's the wait, which is W-A-I-N-T. Why am I not talking? So why am I not a part of the conversation? So it works both ways, being able to have that space to, you know, to share. Amanda says, takeaways, there's still a lot of work to be done, even though orgs are saying they're taking on DEI lens. What can I do using other perspectives within DEI to help others understand why it is so important? Also creating a space where others feel comfortable in speaking up and safe and being able to help and by be a voice for those that may not feel comfortable, educating all leaders on both the ups and downs of DEI, and then how to still be your authentic self, but to be respectful and mindful of their own bias. Awesome. I love that. Thank you so much. Then Erica, she says, I agree. Oftentimes when historically marginalized people speak up, we have greater consequences. Exactly. That was my friend's thing. She was speaking up about a lot of issues and they're like, we didn't hire you to make a difference. We just hired you to fill in the space. So she was like, no, I'm not just going to be taking up space for the sake of taking up space. Even though the money is really, really good, I'm not going to do that. So I was proud of her for actually, deciding differently. What time do we have? Oh, it's 1 o'clock. All right. So I wanted to, and I will send this out to Sarah Lynn. I wanted to give resources. Thank you everyone for like speaking your truth and sharing your stories with us. I really, really appreciate it. All these are going to be provided, I think, after this. I'm not for sure exactly how that works. I'll send the PowerPoint, the Canva to Sarah Lynn. I wanted to just give a couple of resources and I'll make sure that they're included with this too. Just for books, for you know, reference sakes, books to read. And I love children's books because it means so very much to me to be able to have that ground understanding of how we are supposed to enact or react with each other and amongst each other. So the first one is All People Are Beautiful, and it's Vincent Kelly, and it's about diversity and acceptance. And this is a really good one. I got this one like some months ago. My niece actually sent it to me because she knows the work that I do. It's called You Are Your Best Thing. And it's about vulnerability, shame, resilience, and the Black experience. And I think this is Brené Brown and Tamir Rice's mom. I can't remember her name right now. It's so good, so juicy. And then another children's book is My Heart Full of All, and it's about inclusive multicultural. It's a multicultural picture book, and it's by Jia Shao. It's J-I-A-S-H-A-O, and it's about mixed race culture and the gift of self-acceptance, diversity, and inclusiveness. So thank you for your time. Thank you everyone for just showing up and just be willing to have conversations and listening and being part of this process. It's an ever-evolving thing. It's not like I said earlier, it's not a one and done. It's every day we practice, every day we get better, every day we educate ourselves, and every day we learn more and more and more. So thank you for just being here. And until next time, we'll see you soon. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And then fill out the poll before you leave. I see it popped up on the screen. So do your polls. All right. So I'll send you the Canva